You're listening to the Kazual Sportz Show.
Palmer stepping away at first. Palmer extending the play. Nobody crosses the field. Larry Fitzgerald is going to take it into Green Bay territory.
The show exclusively known as the voice of the Arizona Cardinals fan club, the Bird Gang.
Fitzgerald inside the 30. Insane.
Now with your host Earl Burnett, aka Kazual E.
Bird Gang on 3, 1, 2, 3.
Welcome to another start of the week, Monday night. It is the Kazual Sportz Show with Earl Burnett, aka Kazual E, and my co-host, of course, you guys know, the one and only Sean McConnell.
Yeah, man.
All right, and. We always love coming in here on a Monday from a Sunday's Cardinal game with a win. And boy, we get an early start this year. They don't normally come this early. So, but you guys want to be a part of this show tonight and follow us on our four major outlets. Of course, you guys know the tab, Kazual Sportz, K-A-Z-U-A-L, and a Z at the end of the word sports. And that's on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and of course, our YouTube page. And you can also download our mobile app at www.ksrnaz.com and also subscribe to the website as well. And also subscribe to our YouTube page because a lot is going up on the YouTube page now. This show is brought to you by the good folks at CASA, Court-Appointed Special Advocates. Change a child's story. We are trying to do what we can in the Valley and in any community to change the a child's story that is in the foster system. And my man next to me over here knows all about those things, and I'm sure we're going to have him be the spokesperson of that sooner enough.
Yeah, I just got to find myself a nice suit and tie, you know?
Exactly. I got hit up by CASA actually yesterday, and they were like, okay, when are we going to get something going? So, okay, hold on. We in the works. We just got to tweak some things here and there so everybody's, you know, anxious and doing something with that. But yes, if you want to volunteer, just go ahead and hit us up at our website, www.ksrnaz.com, or just go ahead and hit us up on a call or shoot us a phone call at 602-563-KSRN, 602-563-KSRN, and that's 5776, in case you didn't know.
And if that contact form doesn't work on the website, blame Earl. He made the website. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, right. You the one made the website.
Ah, man, you look way more official than me. I'm rocking a tank top right now from Haiti, and you're over here with a nice old KSRN polo. I didn't have time to get suited up, man. So you look like you're the businessman. I'm just the dude.
Nah, it's all good, man. You know what you do with this company, dude. Don't even downplay your stuff. But also, our other sponsor, Customer First Solutions. When it comes to Customer First Solutions, you as a customer always come first. When it comes to household repairs, painting, plumbing, electrical, Customer First Solutions does it all. You want to get a quote or you want to get some information from that, go ahead and hit them up at 480-877-0255. They will communicate with you via text. And, of course, because of the COVID-19 situation, they will contact you back via text to get you some information of if you want a quote. Their phone number once again is 480-877-0255, Customer First Solutions, where the old saying still counts, that the customer is always first. All right, man, so it's been a really weird week, a really cool, full packed week of sports. I didn't get a chance to say this last week, but Thursday night last week was a pretty interesting historical day in sports. And it was the day of every last major sport had a game going that night, that same night. We had NBA, we had football game, we had Major League Soccer, we had Major League Baseball, we had WNBA. I mean, everybody was playing that night. And that'll probably never happen again, of course, because of this COVID-19. Of course, things might change, but that was pretty interesting. But this week has been loaded. This weekend has been loaded. I mean, those NFL games were running. I forgot that there was an NBA playoff game that was going on that same night.
That's the NFL effect right there, man. We already know the NFL does that.
I'm missing all out on it. I'm like, dang, I missed that. But, man, Denver Nuggets ain't playing around. Well, I think we underestimated them, man.
No, a lot of people did.
Everybody underestimated them. But before I go into what's going on in the world of sports, I got a couple of Bird Gang announcements that I have to make.
Ladies and gentlemen, can I please have your attention? I've just been handed an urgent news story. And I need all of you to stop what you're doing and listen. And listen. And listen.
All right, Bird Gang. Of course, I got the same announcements that I have going on. I'm going to announce those same three announcements again, simply because they are pretty important events that are going down. Our good friends at the Be Daring Foundation is putting on a mental health summit. And like I said last week, this thing comes at a perfect time, because there's a lot of this going around with these sports athletes right now. Not just sports athletes. It's not only athletes, of course, we know that, but bigger faces that come out and admit to these things and let everybody know what's going on with these type of things is really important when it comes to this type of thing that's going around. And it's all over the place. And people that you never know are going through it are going through it. So my good friend down there, of course, Michelle DeMaria, runs that whole thing. And she does an awesome job at keeping us aware about mental health. And she has a whole lot of workshops and all types of things that can help in this aspect as well. So if you want to get some help in that aspect, reach out to Michelle DeMaria on Facebook, or you can get in touch with me here at KSRN, and we'll get in touch with her for you. But this summit is 3 days, 4 through 7 on November, 4th through the 7th, I should say, in November this month, coming up this November. And she has a lot of guest speakers and workshops, a virtual networking going on, social media campaigns. And she has a speaker, too, that's going to be the ambassador of the whole thing. Diana, I hope I get the last name right. Ryle, I believe. But she is going to be the ambassador of this thing and speaking for, again, the Pave the Way Mental Health Summit, November 4th through 7th, with the Be Daring Foundation. That's Michelle DeMaria. Hit her up on Facebook. And, of course, I told you guys about what our boy P2 is doing every Tuesday to come out in the community and help out the feeding of the homeless. P2 is going to be down at the U Moms shelters throughout the valley every Tuesday. During the football season, he will be out there every Tuesday to go feed the homeless. He's going to ask you, Bird Gang, that you could come out and support him and help feed the homeless. And also, you can donate to the cause. If you want to donate to the cause, you can go ahead and go to umoms.org. That's U, the letter U, mom.org. No S at the end. umom.org. And please do us a big, big favor. Don't crowd the man trying to get autographs and all that type of stuff. He is out there to do a service to the community, and he wants you, Bird Gang, to come on out there and do as well. And the way he played yesterday, man, y'all should be flocking down there. That's P2 doing his service, and also to honor Kobe Bryant, in the memory of Kobe Bryant, because Kobe did a lot of that in L.A. for the homeless. And finally, Bird Gang, like I said before, the stadium is closed the first two home games, and I know everybody's itching to go in that stadium right about now, but hopefully the third game of the season, the stadium will be open. We'll keep you posted, but get your mask. Get your custom Bird Gang mask from my man, Mike Durarte. He is the man to go to. Let's support the Bird Gang. Support our Bird Gang brother. And you know, Mike's work, you know what he does, how his digital photography is awesome, it's top of the line. He has every design you can think of that would have a bird gang involved in it for a mask, from the beak to the bird to the players to whatever you want to name. He has it. So go ahead and hit him up, Facebook and Instagram, Mike Durarte. And Durarte's with a Y-D-U-A-R-T-E. And those are our bird gang announcements. And so with that, we're going to get on in the rest of the show and find out what's going on in this crazy world of COVID-19 sports. Well, of course, a lot is going on. We could talk about every major sport, but tonight we're going to just only concentrate on two of those because there's so many things to get to, and we know the rest of this show is going to be for our Cardinals because we know they went in there and put it down on that Frisco team. They went in there and launched a nuclear bomb. Oh, matter of fact.
Snooked the bastards.
Oh, my
God. Nuclear bomb.
We went in there and nuked them fools with the nuke bomb, man. I'm telling you. But we're going to definitely talk about that. That was freaking awesome what they did. I think it was calculated that that happened that way, but we'll talk about that. But let's start in the NBA because the playoffs are starting to heat up. They've been heated up, but man, like I said, the Denver Nuggets, I think we're sleeping on this team, bro. And they feel like they've been slept on as well. And the Clippers are in trouble, right?
For good reason.
Matter of fact, both them L.A. teams are in trouble. Don't sleep that Denver's not able to take down the other L.A. team as well. I think they can. They are built for it. This team has everything they need, except when they get one of those lulls when they just lose it for a second. And just, you know, fall asleep. But when they're on, they are tough to beat. And now that Porter kid's going to start getting up to speed. And, man, I would imagine that this will be tough for both them L.A. teams to beat that team.
Yeah, I mean, you could argue that Denver is actually better set up for the Lakers matchup than the Clippers are.
Oh, good point.
Because the Clippers, you match up with the stars and then what?
Right, right.
The Lakers.
Who's going to match up with AD?
Exactly. Of course, you know,
Jokic got that down. That'd be a washout.
That should be, right, in that theory.
Yeah. Man, so, yeah, that would be interesting to see. But in a game seven, you can't count out that Kawhi element.
Oh, man.
I mean, I know that dude is going to show up, and that dude is going to be hard to stop.
He's been in some game sevens. He knows a little bit about him.
I would imagine. But it's going to be pretty interesting to see how that goes. And, of course, on the other side, the Heat and Boston are going to fight it out on a defensive end, and then the offense is just going to be like secondary to everything because they're going to kill each other on defense. but they both got good offenses too as well, so that's going to be one heck of a series. I think on both these Western and Eastern Conference Finals, when both the winners come out of that, it's going to be a wore out, tired, two tired, wore out opponents going to the championship, and who can persevere is going to be the one who wins through this whole thing.
But, and that's true. That does play into the Lakers' favor, obviously, right?
Yes, yes. I mean, obviously, because they got the easier second round. I mean, they went up against a cupcake, so we good. We know how that went down. And speaking of that, which that takes me into our next little spot, is Mr. Cupcake System got let go today.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, Mike D'Antoni got axed. And I'm hoping, and I'm not downing him as the person because I don't ever want to see a man lose his job. But I'm hoping that damn system got axed with him and we never see it again. I'm sorry. That's just how I feel, man. I'm sorry.
That hits me right in my son's pride right there, man.
I'm sorry. But back then when the Suns had that opportunity to go to the championship and the two dudes come off the bench, Amari and
Boris
come off the bench.
Right, that bring was that the up.
Year. That was the year where they probably had an opportunity to let that system go into a championship and win it.
Well, you bring
Everybody
that up.
Has caught up to that crap by now. Everybody has figured it out now. Everybody knows what to do when they play that team in that system.
Unless you're the Warriors.
Exactly. It's not going to win a championship unless you do what the Warriors did with it. Incorporate some defense, please. Incorporate some defense.
Defense?
Yeah, what the hell is that? Mike D'Antoni probably don't know what that means. It's like, my goodness. But yeah, I hope that thing is gone for good. But there's a did I let that run out? Yeah, I sure did. There's a lot of superstars that might be trying to, or might be thinking of you know.
Oh, no. Not the banana boat.
You know what I'm saying? Trying to, okay, I want to rethink how I'm doing this thing. This thing, I thought it was going to get us here this time, but it ain't working out, man. And it's, I mean, it's not to say that it's going to happen, but it's possible. You know, of course, Kawhi, if he loses this game with this Clipper team, could he want out? Could he say this was not the right thing to do and find another team?
Could.
Paul George as well.
But those are LA guys.
Yeah, you would think they'd stay right there, right?
I think it just depends on how bad the Lakers beat them, right? I mean, that's really the...
That's true.
You get swept.
But I'm not so much talking about the Lakers beating them. I'm talking about if they lose to this Nugget team.
Well, absolutely. That's even more demoralizing, right?
Because you could go ahead and lose to the Lakers when we already know that was going to be a battle. That was going to be an even matchup. And if you lose to the Lakers, ain't no shame in that. But if you lose to this Nugget team, not saying there's any shame in that as well, but I'm just saying you were expected to be in the Western Finals. And if you come up short, will he say, hey, this didn't work and blow that thing up?
I think they give it one more year, one more. Okay. Hey, let's see if we can add some more pieces. Because, like you said, there's a lot of people that might be moving this offseason.
What about the two Rockets, Harden and Westbrook? Are they going to do it again? Because whatever coach come in there, they're not going to play that same system. They're going to make them two dudes work and play defense.
Well,
I hope
one of them goes to the Clippers, because that'll just ruin the whole Clippers chemistry in their whole season. So that'll help the Suns out.
Some of these West dudes need to start matriculating over to the East. Get out of here so the Suns can have a chance to kind of at least creep up a little bit on y'all.
It's been like 12 years. Someone go to the East, please.
No?
Please.
Damn. Please. AD next year can also be one of those guys that could come out, but I'm pretty sure he's going to stay locked to LeBron's coattails because he's got something that's helping him get through the harder part of figuring out how to win a championship. He's got the man that's been doing it. So
yeah, he'll stay.
And then, of course, Giannis, that's the one that I'm concentrating on.
You think Giannis is going to leave?
I don't think so now that this news has come out today that the Bucks have reached out to him and his agent has said, don't worry, please. We are going to spend to get pieces around you.
Oh, my goodness.
So they're letting it be known. We're going to spend some money to find some people to get around you. Don't leave, Giannis. We got you. So... If they could convince him, and he seems like the loyal type of guy to me, so I would imagine he would be back there. But man, he's not going anywhere. Would the teams around this league start salivating and scrapping over each other to get to that dude?
He's not going anywhere.
He ain't going anywhere. I know. But hey, we can dream, right? It could be a pipe dream.
No, man. The last dream I had was Aldridge, and that ended poorly, very poorly.
Why?
We've never had a power forward that was like that. Come on, man.
Power forward pick and that could shoot. Yeah, he can. He can shoot. I don't know if he's going to be back the same player he used to be. So
no, he's on the decline for sure.
Yeah, he had his chance to be a Son, and he flipped us off when we put that big old billboard down there for him. He didn't even come see that bad boy.
That thing was fresh off the Kinko's printer, and we couldn't even get it up fast enough. And he's like, "Nah, I'm good. I'm out."
He just left. He didn't even come see that bad boy. I was like, man, so we don't want that dude.
Disrespect. Dodged a bullet there.
But, yeah, it's going to be a lot of guys that's going to be available probably and probably going to force their way out. I could see Harden doing that right now. He looks frustrated to me. Come on home, dude.
You want the non-defensive playing James Harden in the system that you hate to come over here and not play defense with Booker, who does not play defense, and just make Bridges the only defender we got. That's what you want? Earl, that's up. That's like top five of the ideas that I don't know what you're thinking. That's like a Dez Bryant idea that you had last year.
I'm thinking Dez Bryant. I'm thinking we can hide him on defense. Yeah, because we got so much talent on that front line with the length and everything. We can hide him on defense, but the scoring punch would be, man, unmatched with him and Book together. But it wouldn't match because they don't fit, because he would have to have the ball dominant in his hand, and I get that. But, man, come on home. We'll figure something out.
All right, so I can see it now. The Suns have the ball. James Harden misses a 60-footer, right? And he just stays put, and everyone else goes back to the other side of the court, and he's just sitting there waiting.
Well, you gotta look at it like this too. Do you think do you really think Monty's gonna allow him to play like that? Please.
I hope not.
No way. If he was to come here, he would be pissed off at Monty Williams. Oh, you making me work now? He's probably gonna lose some pounds. Because he going to make that dude work if he came here. You know, way he going to be sitting on no perimeter shooting and just doing what he do. Thinking it's not going to be that Houston system to begin with. Defense here now.
I'm all for the local kid coming back. You know, I'm all for the ASU kid coming back.
It ain't going to happen. I'm just throwing stuff out there because we trying to pass some time.
That'd be a weird one. That'd scratch a head for sure.
Absolutely. Absolutely. We're going to take our first break because we got a lot of Cardinal talk to get into, man. And, boy, was this one hell of an excellent game. Not pretty. Not pretty. A win is a win is a win is a win. And I don't have to say that again, but it is what it is.
Nuked them.
But we straight nuked them, fools. Stick around, Bird Game. We're going to talk some nuke them. And some nuke, I should say. And the Cardinals game that went down on Sunday. Sorry I didn't get to do the casual look for you guys, but we couldn't do it all in one shot. Stick around. We'll be right back. Earl Burnett, Sean McConnell, Kazual Sportz Show right here on KSRN.
Nuke them. Let's nuke the bastards.
Like a nuclear bomb.
We're going to take a little break, but we'll be back in a while, so don't nobody go nowhere.
This is the sound of a racing heart. It's beating a little faster because it belongs to a young child. But this child isn't in the middle of a close soccer game or playing with her puppy in the yard. Her heart is racing because she's just been told she has to move foster homes again. Change a child's story. There's a child waiting for a volunteer like you. Learn how you can help at CasaForChildren.org.
This is Larry Fitzgerald. You listen to the exclusive voice of the Bird Gang, Kazual Sportz.
Hey, Bird Gang, this is Chase Ebbing, and I ride with the exclusive voice of the Bird Gang, Kazual E. The Kazual Sportz Show on KSRN Arizona.
Cliff Kingsbury, and you're listening to the second best sounding voice in the valley, Kazual E, on the Kazual Sportz Show here on KSRN Arizona.
Welcome back, Bird Gang, Suns Nation, all you wonderful fans out there, the Kazual Sportz Show, Earl Burnett, Sean McConnell.
You.
We are coming off a win.
Woo!
I mean, and let's just be honest, it was a win that was at least predicted by a few of us. I was in there, you know, I was in there, so I got to admit, it wasn't new to me, but good win, though, good win. I can find my audio here. I can get rid of this music.
You started right out.
Before Facebook attacked us. that's tight. All right. Man, a lot went down. Before we get into the Cardinals real fast, I want to cover a little bit of NFL stuff.
Weird week.
Sunday was the debut of the Sunday games, I should say, Sunday games, and the full scale. What's going on with that Denver game tonight? Not that I really care about it, but just
I care about it, man. I got two of these running backs in my fantasy teams, bro, and it's tied 7-7. 3 minutes left in the second.
Okay, well, Denver's game tonight, even though they're missing some people, but they're game tonight. But give me a little bit of what you think about this Sunday's games, and what I'm saying by not so much as each individual game. I'm talking about things like this, like the crowds of crowdless stadiums. What did that look like? And, you know, the fake crowd noise that was getting pumped into every stadium.
Right.
Things like the play, you know, the style of play and how was the play. Because I thought the play a little bit was a lot better than I thought it would be. You know, so, I mean, what do you think as far as a couple of those things? What stood out as far as this whole Sunday that, well, you know, stood out to you?
I want to go local first because obviously that's the game I watched 100% intently, wasn't chasing kids around. I was locked in, volume all the way up. To me, it felt like San Francisco had their their soundboard, right? And it was just they got two options. You got the regular crowd murmur, and then you got the crowd goes loud, goes crazy soundbite, right? And all they're doing is just turning the volume up and down. It was a kickoff, horrible. And all of a sudden they flip it all the way up, and everyone's going crazy. It was a kickoff. What are you doing?
Crazy. They could at least hire some people that at least know football.
And they were doing it when San Fran was on offense, like so that we couldn't hear the play count because it was that obvious or something that Jimmy G's like, yo, we're going to pass it to 10. We're going to pass it to 10. Hike. Like,
yeah.
What are you doing?
Funny because when he was getting sacked, the crowd was,
the crowd was going nuts.
I'm like, wait a minute. That don't sound right.
Hey, Bird Gang was in the building on Sunday. It showed, man. Yeah,
There you go. I guess that's the way to look at it.
As far as the style of play.
That crowd thing. I think that.
The style of play, for the Cardinals specifically, I texted you the first quarter. I was like, man, nothing's changed. Nothing's changed. We're just as bad. We're screwing up. I'm all over, right? One quarter. Totally forgetting that there's been no preseason or anything. So some teams had some adjustments. Like the Patriots game, that was ugly. Right. That was brutal, right? Cam looked good, but nothing else about the game looked good. The whole game was trash. Cleveland was trash.
Cam looked good only from a running perspective. He looked horrible throwing the ball.
Right. But, I mean that's what I expect from Cam.
You're talking about that offense where you got to complete 5 to 7 yard passes, and you can't even, you know, do that better than that.
It seemed like Edelman never practiced at all. It seemed like they'd never played catch.
And that's to be expected. I get that. He's still learning that system and all those things. But, I mean, and that's going to look like when he does pick up the system, it's going to look the same way. They're not expecting him to throw the ball a lot of yards. It's going to be him methodically going up and down the field little by little. And now they're adding an element of him running, and that's probably lighting up Bill Belichick's eyes. They made him go in there and run to see what they're going to look like. And he's tough to stop, man. He's a big load to bring down in a short yardage system, short yard stuff.
So. I didn't expect seeing that. The Philadelphia-Washington game, I expected that to be as weird as it was. I picked it wrong, but I still thought it was going to be weird. Detroit fooled me again. I should have never picked them on an opener. Detroit losing the opener. Green Bay, Minnesota. Green Bay showed more spunk than I thought they were going to do. Minnesota took a step back.
I tried to tell y'all on NutriZone, not that quarterback. They don't play well against the Packers early in the season.
That's fair.
Minnesota is one of those teams that wait to the last minute to start playing good football. And that's 5 to 6 games going into trying to make the playoff run.
That's fair.
The beginning, they get their butts kicked by everybody because that quarterback just don't come with the same. I don't know what makes him kick in late than early. I don't know what it is.
He just doesn't curl right, to quote Jay.
He don't curl right, exactly.
I got two more things across the NFL, and I don't want to get into every game, obviously, but
yeah, of course.
Brady and
he looked like crap.
Brady and BA. Oh. It's gonna take time, and going up against New Orleans in Game 1, that's rough. That's rough.
I'm going to rebut you on that.
Give it time.
It's going to take time, yes, but how much time? He's 43. He ain't got that much time.
I'm talking like the Carson Palmer effect. Like it was like 3 games, and then, okay, we got our groove.
Yeah, I know what you're saying, but I'm saying being 43.
Oh, it's like this or nothing.
Can he really get that? Can he start to really look like he's supposed to look? I'm thinking when you talk about aging, dude, your mind can say one thing, but that body's going to say another. Everybody can attest to that.
And here's what plays into that. Carson was built way more tough to take hits like that than Brady was. Because B.A., we know he wants his quarterback to hold on to the ball the last second and take that hit. Brady's not used to that. And if he is, he's used to red, yellow flags flying all over the place. It's not going to happen in the NFC. It doesn't happen that way. Right. Last thing I got, the Cowboys. They dropped, literally dropped the ball to win that game. They gave the Rams that game, man. They had every chance.
They dropped the ball.
3 minutes left. You got the last drive, and you just let Jalen Ramsey destroy you.
I think the referees had a lot to do with that, but whatever. Who cares?
Not in the Cowboys' favor? Since when?
If they lose, who cares? I mean, even somebody asked me, you want the Cowboys to – to win because you want to root for them because you want the Rams to lose. I went, no, it don't matter. I ain't rooting for no Cowgirl. Sorry. Exactly. It don't matter. Whatever happens, happens. I live with the Rams winning.
That's one of those games you have to pick, and you're like, well, I guess I'll pick one. Flip a coin.
You know? Yeah. But, I mean, on a quick note about Brady real fast, though,
yeah.
I mean, interesting that B.A., you know B.A. will not hold his tongue.
Of course not. That's why we love him.
B.A. came out straight. I said, I was surprised he struggled against this team, against this, you know. And I'm like, why not, B.A.? He was like, the dude is 40 freaking three. That's an old man you talk about. Well, he's 7 years away from 50 playing football.
That's
and
true.
You want him to just come in there and just be the same Brady that won all the time. It's not happening, people. I mm-mm. said that before this whole thing started. He is not going to light it up there. He's going to be short game, short, and he's going to struggle because he's still trying to learn that system. How much time do you think Brady has left? Eventually, that arm's going to turn to a noodle at some point.
Sooner or later, right?
I mean, you know? And he looked bad from two standpoints. He looked old, and he looked like a person that didn't have the system down, which is, I get the system part, but being old, you can't do nothing about that.
And I know Mike
Evans.
By
the time you pick up that system, you're going to be 44.
I know Evans was banged up too, but only four targets?
Yeesh. Yeah. Chemistry is everything, bro.
That's your chemistry right there.
Let's do this real quick. Other guys that changed teams, how did they look? Because the same Phillip Rivers showed up.
Rivers gonna Rivers,
my man JB Bridges, former Cardinal of the JB Benny Blue Review, said that on the neutral zone. He said, yeah, they still got F up Rivers. He just and he did exactly that down the stretch. And he's proven again, he's old, 38 years old. His arm is not where his mind thinks he can get the ball in certain spots, but he can't get it there.
Right.
That's the same thing Brady's dealing with. So just watch it all season long. Y'all, everybody going to be coming down off the, what's wrong with the GOAT? What's wrong with the GOAT? And I'm going to go back to my same stuff. The GOAT benefited from a hell of a system that made him the GOAT. Sorry, y'all. Just deal with it. That's the truth.
GOAT's going to turn into one of those
anyway, before
goats.
We go to the next thing. And we got a serious, a lot of injuries went down. A lot of injuries. Too many to even name. Just some notables. I have my casualties promo ready, but I don't have it up, so I'm gonna have to skip it. Don't have time for it. But anyway, the casualties report: Dallas, of course, we know Vander Esch is gonna be out 6 to 8 weeks. Colts lost Marlon Mack for the season. Falcons lose Denard just for a few weeks, maybe. The Browns lose Greedy Williams and Jedrick Wills, the rookie that just got there,
yep.
Probably gonna be out a few weeks or maybe day to day. Lions lose Desmond Trufant. Jets, Lev Bell with a hamstring, and his ego is hurt. The Bears are losing Kendall Fuller right now. He's going to be out, and we're going to focus on our Cardinals right now. We got three major guys out right now that took some injuries on Sunday. DJ Humphries, an air undisclosed injury. They're not even letting us know what that is, so those are scary ones all the time.
Yep.
And you got Mason Cole, hamstring, and Jalen Thompson with an ankle, so –
And Josh Jones didn't play.
Josh Jones was out to begin with, right?
Yep.
And so, man, what I wanted to say about what I saw on that Sunday was, man, okay, I thought the football was going to be sloppy. It was not. It was pretty good. Scoring was up, was okay. Defenses struggled because right. That's why the scoring was up, and I get that. That's because no practice, no training camp.
No tackling drills,
one
no
thing
nothing.
That stood out to me about this whole Sunday, and I'm sitting there flipping the game, people out there are hitting their butts off in these games.
Mm.
I mean, I saw some legal major big hits in this in football. You know why? Because all season, off season long, these guys have been hitting each other and can't have to hold up and hold back. And then you get no preseason games to go let off that steam. So people were letting off steam. And man, that Cardinal 49er game was one physical game.
Yeah, it was physical.
I mean, I saw people getting hit, flipping around. I'm like, wow, they are hitting out there. And that was not just that game. It was most of the games
were really
physical.
There was one that was such a nasty hit. It was legal.
Yeah, it was all of them. Look, all of them were legal.
Which one it was? There was one game. It was, I want to say it was an AFC game, but it was brutal.
Yeah, yeah. I was looking at all of them. I'm like, wow. And another thing that stood out to me, of course, was the kicking game was horrible all throughout the NFL. How many missed extra points did we see? How many missed easy field goals? I mean, our own Zane missed two. I mean, it's like, come on, man. These are field goals. And then he turned around and hit his dang on career long and then can't hit the first two. I'm like, what the hell is that? But all Sunday, missed extra points. I was like, 6-0. I'm like, what the hell? 10
apparently,
to nine.
The crowds matter.
I'm like, okay, who?
The crowds matter.
I guess so.
It's wow. Too quiet for them.
It sure is. And then that's another thing that looked weird. Just seeing an NFL game empty stadium like that just threw me off.
As long as the camera was in tight enough, you wouldn't notice. But once they zoomed out, you're like, why are you zooming out? You're making me
zoom out. I'm thinking I thought I was in Canada, dude. I'm like, is this the Canadian League?
Speaking of Canada, Chris Streveler, baby.
Oh, I told you, dog. I told you he's going. Yeah, he is right. He was the backup, bro. He was the backup.
It's career NFL career high 3-yard run right there.
Absolutely, man. Hold on a second. We're going into Cardinal talk.
Hey, yo, what's good, Bird Gang? This is Jay Love. And where do you go when you want to get all the information about the Arizona Cardinals? Of course, you come to Kazual Sportz in the Kazual House. You can.
Yeah, that's from our man, Jay. No believe in the Cardinals love.
Oh.
You know I'm going to take my shots, man. I'm going to take my shots. But, man, I told you our boy Strev, man. He is going to.
Is the next Taysom Hill.
That's it. That's what they were copying that.
That's
they're
a
copying
big dude.
The world team.
That's a big dude.
He's a big. He is a big dude. But I love it. I love it. I think. Man, we're going to get that score out of him this year, and you're going to be having to pay up that bet for sure. But,
yeah, probably right.
But let's see. Where do we even start with this Cardinal game, man? Where do we even start? Let's just start from the top. Give me not plays or anything that happened in the game, but give me the main thing that stood out to you or the main key of what you saw Sunday.
A philosophy. I'm going to try and get crazy on you. A philosophy can only be as effective as your most dynamic aspect. The DeAndre Hopkins effect is real. Right. It is real. Once it started to work, it took a little bit, but once it started to work, and then Kyler started to run and scramble, the 49ers were on their toes.
Oh, my goodness.
On their toes so much so that they forgot to guard the man. They forgot to guard the man. The man, not double him, not triple him, but nobody.
Yeah. That was calculated.
Incredible.
That was calculated by Shanahan for sure. Because I'm telling y'all, like I said, last year, those two games that we lost to them, we did the same thing. They could not control Kyler.
Right.
Couldn't control him. And so they were coming in that game and saying, we can't let this kid beat us. And he ended up beating you. And you didn't make the adjustment on the receiver he was throwing the ball to. So
would have had 100 rushing yards if it wasn't for those kneel backs at the end.
Right, right. One thing I am going to say about this that I have not heard anybody say all day today about DeAndre Hopkins 14-151. Okay, we know that was a spectacular day.
Career high, too.
Career high. But I'm thinking that was purposely done, man. They didn't just walk into that. I don't think so. I think with having no offseason, no preseason, no way to get that chemistry down with those two. They use that game to get them two on track.
And you know how easy it is to get chemistry when the dude does 14 to 16 catches?
Right.
That goes by quick.
Oh, yeah.
That chemistry builds quick.
Yeah. I mean, just look at the time when there was a couple of times where they were off.
Oh, yeah.
As they were working through, it in that game in live action. Practice was going on in live action. Because it was basically a glorified preseason game.
Of course. It just happened to be divisional.
And that's for the whole league. Everybody's trying to figure out where they're going to, you know, what's going to do and how they're going to run this. But to get them two to get on that page, 14 connections out of 16 targets, they were practicing and they were hitting on it. And then they start getting into a flow and then they just made them dudes look bad.
Yeah.
Sorry. And it's bad for Shanahan not to make an adjustment to double that dude. Come on now.
And then this is something that we've seen before and it needs to be noticed because obviously it feels common sense, but we need to talk about it.
Right.
This is Larry Fitzgerald 2.0, right? This is how you build chemistry. You throw it in their direction. Now it's not Larry's direction. It's their direction. Either one. they're going to go get it. Right. 9 times out of 10 or 14 out of 16, they're going to go get it. And that's how Kyler, okay, I can really throw it anywhere and Hopkins is going to get it. He was jumping up. He was jumping out. He was leaping. He was
he even
toe touching.
He said that afterward. He said, I could throw it anywhere. He'll go. He'll come down with it. And that kid is no joke. He has a different – he has that it factor that Fitz had when Fitz was young, that Julio has, that it – that Jerry Rice factor that knows – you know that guy is different from everybody else.
Yeah.
He just looks that way. He just feels that. He did not seem like he was struggling at all to do anything.
It was a different level.
He was on a totally different level.
Yeah.
And the kid don't practice that well. Can you imagine if he would actually buckle down and practice the way Fitz practices?
We talk about practice.
You talk about unstoppable force.
They already is. I wouldn't He's practice either.
I guess whatever they broke, don't fix it.
Right?
They broke. Leave that bug alone. But one thing that stood out to me is what I did not like, and we saw this last year, is the cute play calling by Cliff Kingsbury early.
Yeah, that's true.
You can tell that he came into that game going, okay, I know that we ran on this team last year, and they're going to try to stop our runs. Let's surprise them and come out and pet. No, dude, come on now. Let's stop doing that cute stuff, because all that's doing is taking away the rhythm of your running back.
Right.
If Drake doesn't touch the ball for the first 9 freaking plays, then you just all of a sudden hand it to him. I mean, you got to get him in a rhythm with everybody else. And I think that destroys his rhythm when he doesn't get the running game going and keep them balanced. When they're balanced like they were yesterday, they are going to be a tough team to beat.
Yeah.
They're going to be a tough team to beat. And at the end of that game, Hopkins said exactly that you know, when that game got going, we tough to beat.
And that's absolutely right. I mean, now that you have Hopkins and you have the weapons that you have, all of this is about is just keeping the defense honest. Once you keep the defense honest, you can pick it apart.
Yeah, you got it.
Sorry, I didn't know you had a sound. No, yeah, you can pick apart defenses and just play with them that way. That's where the game is. You don't have to get cute. You can get cute on fourth and whatever if you want to take a shot here and there, but pick your poison.
Jay and Ed asked me on the Believe the Cardinals podcast a couple of weeks ago when I was on there about that exact thing. And Jay said, and he was right, will he stick to what was working last year at the end of the season? And he was right. He didn't. He came in trying to change it up to that spread them out type of deal, and it didn't work. But I told him this as well. I said, when it doesn't work, he'll go back to what works. And when he went back to it, they looked like the team that was balanced again.
Right.
So I think that's the system now. Stop trying to go back to that, spread it out and trying to, you know, nobody's falling for that. Go ahead and keep that power running game in it. That's what's going to keep everybody honest on the defensive end, especially when Kyler's running out for 100 yards. He put that on tape now. Everybody's scared now.
Yeah.
Everybody's like, okay, how are we going to defend that team?
Especially during that defense. Come on.
Yeah,
Quan Alexander was killing us.
Oh, man. And so now you go, man, okay, I knew the offense was going to be okay. They struggled when they came out. They were still practicing, trying to get on the point. I wanted to see what this defense was going to look like. And, boy, when you text me, we were on the same page. I was like, here we go again. Mm-hmm. Damn tight end, running free. First couple of plays. There goes Kittle. There he goes. Oh, they go to running back out of the backfield. What the hell?
Yep.
But those mistakes were from our rookie. Those mistakes were from Simmons, and that's to be expected from a rookie. When, especially the big play when Mostert came out of there, he overcommitted to the edge, thinking for sure that Jimmy was throwing that in the flat to the running back.
Yeah, just and went right for it.
And the running back went inside, and bam, he got beat big time because he kept his eyes on Jimmy G, especially in man-to-man. You don't do that.
No.
You play man-to-man, you stay on your man. And so he's going to learn, and he had a rough day. He had a pretty rough day, the horse collar tackle, and then he got beat for 2 touchdowns. So that's going to be – we got to see how he reacts to that next week. Can he come back and bounce back from a bad game? But the defense, man, the defense played outstanding. Outstanding. Did they get beat here and there? Did they look – you know, yeah, every defense is going to bend, but if you don't break, that makes the difference. I love what they did in the red zone. On the defensive end, holding that team to 13 points all the way to the fourth quarter.
Yeah.
A whole goal line stand and the final, you know, you tell me, I mean, tell me at the end when we scored the 24-20 and they had the ball with the 2 minutes.
Too much time.
They were running the ball just methodically, just saying, okay, we're going to take our time and go down and get there and win this thing, right? You thought for sure that was going to happen.
Yeah, we gave them too much time. Yeah.
They had a lot of time, but kudos to the defense.
Here's two things I got on the defense. One, obviously, Patrick Peterson, one pass defended. It happens to be arguably the most important one of the game. So call me the Patrick Peterson defender all you want. I'm with it.
No.
The man's going to get that extension. It's just going to be late in the year, I think. Byron Murphy is what's advertised.
Yes.
2 for 2 on stops there. The one thing I got to go with, Devon Kennard did not see much. Just one tackle out of him. I want to see more. We need to see more.
But it was the most important tackle on that goal line.
That is fair. With Isaiah Simmons, yeah, we need him to get up to speed quick, fast, in a hurry. Obviously, no preseason, anything. That hurts him, right? That hurts him big time. But the longer that we have Hicks running in coverage, the more troubles we're going to have.
Oh, I'm glad you said that.
We knew that last year, and it's the same this year. Nothing's changed. He didn't get faster.
Yes.
It is what it is with him. So if Hicks is in coverage, we're going to get exploited.
He's still having problems trying to figure out which guy he's supposed to take.
Yeah.
And, man, but I got to give props. Like, you just talk about being a P2 guy. Hey, what last year and the last few years were what they were. It is what it was.
Yeah.
But this P2 is the old P2. He's definitely back because
he played all game doing nothing, just hanging out.
And he got surprised at the end because he wasn't, you know, he got.
Oh, crap. Yeah.
Yeah, but tell me this. Wasn't that the exact same play, that exact same team in our building? Exact play. Well, what happened in that play last year?
He
tried it like, oh, that dude was open. Leave him alone, whatever. The difference was the effort.
Yeah.
His effort and his desire and effort to have that C on his chest now, know that he's the example out there. And he his speed made up that gap so fast. and he was smart enough not to foul the guy, not to get that penalty. So he just put his hands out. He knew the ball was coming down and he got it tipped off his head. I said, that was a brilliant play from an all-star corner. Period.
Yeah.
It wasn't luck. That dude knew that ball was coming down. He knew it was going to hit him. He didn't know where it was going to hit him, but he did an excellent job getting back in that play after that guy got around him and beat him.
That was almost a basketball defensive play.
Absolutely.
Ball's going to hit me, but it's not going to touch you.
And I'm going to tell you, like I keep saying this all the time, when that leader on the D or offense or whoever it is, when the leader is going like that, the troops follow.
Yeah.
And that swagger and that arrogance of we can cover anybody just trickled down to B Merv to make them two plays at the end. I mean, it was just awesome to see that kid. I mean, you got some help with a quarterback that threw the ball late and behind his receiver, but who cares?
Yeah.
The guy was where he was supposed to be.
We're going to need to see how the secondary does with a little bit more pass happy, deep threat teams,
like the Rams.
Of course. Of course. But we play the Niners twice, and that benefits us because all they play is a short game.
Right.
So.
Right. What did you think about the lack of Christian Kirk and Andy Isabella? I take that too. Of course, they were practicing with D-Hop, and they knew that was going to happen. I just thought I seriously think that because it wasn't like Christian wasn't getting open because he got open. Kyler was locked on Hop the whole time.
I mean, you get 37 targets and 16 of them go to one guy.
Right.
Some people are going to get left out. Like, that's normal. But Kirk was 1 for 5. It's a tough spot too, because right now we're not playing a lot of slot stuff. I think Kingsbury's holding back a little bit. And I think as defenses forget about Kirk and start to maybe double Hopkins and get a little lazy because Hopkins is lighting us up. He's lighting us up. Then that's when it's going to start to break free. Because then you, again, in the middle of the season, keep all the teams honest, and then they go back to single-man coverage, and then we're back to Hop doing 150 yards.
Here's one more thing on that D-Hop thing, and I'm going to leave that for the rest of the week because we need something to talk about.
You're going
to
nuke it.
But again. Nuke the bastards. That's what happened to the 49ers. We nuked the bastards. But, man, you got to be thinking that that kid came into that game after seeing what the other guy in the other half of that trade did Thursday night and played so well, and you want to outdo that guy to make that trade look even more better.
No.
You know that's what happened. You to do when you're watching Thursday night football, and everybody's giving all these accolades to David Johnson. Oh, he looks so good. Hop like, okay, I'm going to show y'all that trade was still stupid. Watch. And he went out there and blasted Bill O'Brien with that performance. It had something to do with that. I'm sticking to that.
No, I don't buy it. 1 second. David Johnson gets 77 yards. He doubled it. Okay, we already all knew this trade was stupid. That's David Johnson did good. Shout out to David Johnson. We're happy for him, obviously. But their highest receiving receiver was Will Fuller, 112, right? 8 receptions, 10 targets. That's great. That's great, yeah, Mel. It's a bummer they don't have a number one receiver. That's what he did.
My whole point was the trade itself, and to show that that trade was so bad. But the discrepancy is going to look like that on the field, and that's what it looked like after the game, right?
Yeah, but I think we all knew that.
Hop wanted to do that and just rub it in. He wanted to rub that in and show Houston up, and he did exactly that. He did exactly that.
That's fine.
He said that's fine.
I don't think he was doing that. I think he's just a killer, man. He just wanted to kill whoever was on the field. He's just a killer.
If you don't think he was doing that, then why did he tweet after the game? Is that what y'all was waiting for? That's what y'all was talking about, right? He know exactly what's going on, bro. I'm trying to tell you. I know, because those type of players like that are just that way, period. They want to show you up. Hey, you want to get rid of me and make me look stupid? All right, okay, I got you. Watch what you – this is what you gave away. Boom.
Hey, if that's what it works for him, that's cool.
It could be one man's opinion. You know, like I said, it could be one man's opinion, but I'm thinking, hey, it has something to do with it, though. But key to that game was the Cardinals on third down defense.
Whew. And offense.
Stopping that team on 2 of 11 on third down, and we were 7 for 14. We were 50% on offense third down. And that was for Kyler, because that's what we're going to get into next. Kyler on third down. That was the Russell Wilson effect, right?
Yeah.
That's that Russell Wilson effect. We got him on this third and long, and we getting them off the field. We're going to get this ball. And that dude come running out there and pick up 17 yards on third down.
And slide. And you hit him, and you're getting extra on it.
Hell yeah. That's the Russell Wilson effect, minus the getting the 30 yard, because Russell goes out, you know, they take them hits. I don't know why those guys want to take hits. Kyler's showing these dudes how to survive in this league. Yeah, and
because even if you trip and touch me in the head, it's still extra. Exactly. It's still extra.
I watched Lamar Jackson, and I'm like, this dude's not going to make it running like that. Mm-mm. I saw this dude run outside with a chance to go out of bounds and cut that bad boy back in and take on a dang DB.
Yeah.
I'm like, you going to okay, all right. And we watched Kyler play baseball yesterday. Kyler stole what? 7 bases sliding in?
I'm just saying, if we could have Kyler DH for the D-backs, that'd be nice every once in a while. I'm just saying.
Let's talk Kyler, man, because I love this dude, this kid's attitude right now. I love his demeanor. And he does. You're going to struggle in that first game with the way this offseason was going to look. We know that. But how he handled it and made that team follow him and lead them to the win was just amazing to me. I'm like, now I know we got an alpha dog for quarterback. I know we got that dude that can lead us to the championship.
Careful.
I know we got it.
Careful, because sooner or later, they're going to start snatching his chain. It's not just Cam Newton. It's not. They're going to start snatching his chain too now. And that's a nicer chain. I mean, K1 with all the diamonds in it. That's a nice chain right there.
I would imagine it's harder to reach down to snatch a chain than reaching up.
They might get it with their cleats or something. I don't know.
But Kyler, man, that dude is the real deal. He was off passing the ball a little bit because he had Kirk open for a nice deep ball and missed him. I mean, flat out missed him. And he was a little bit off on the passing. But when it came to crunch time to win that game, he took over that game and put that team on his back. And that's what leaders do. That's what star quarterbacks do for their teams. And sky's the limit, man. I mean, can they potentially go into that Cowboy game week 6 coming in there 5-0?
I very well think they could. I mean, this schedule has been the most favorable it's been in 5 years. Yeah. Not only did we win our first opener in 5 years, but the schedule has also benefited us the most in 5 years.
Yeah, and you won one, then everybody thought you were not supposed to win.
Yeah. So you're already off on the right foot.
So that makes the other five or four wins look really easy if you beat that team in the opener in their building.
Right.
But
not that matters anymore.
You got to get on the field and play it. We know things can happen, but man, if this team starts to get it together and you put on tape that you have to account for Hopkins with a double team. You can't come in there and play that dude one up. You can't. Right. That's just stupid. That's just bad defensive coordinating.
And then that's when Kirk and Isabella and Larry and big old Dan, they're going to go crazy.
I love Dan Arnold, man. I don't know why everybody's saying we don't have a tight end. We have a good tight end. You just have a tight end that's stuck in between all his other dang on all these other weapons. But he's a weapon himself. That dude, he can catch the rock and he can block and he can do everything we need on this offense. I mean, on the offense from the tight end position. Give me your player that stood out in this game that just, you know, performed at a high level. I mean, as a group, they did together, but there were some players that did some things that stuck out, like Angelo Blackson. Like, when I saw that dude come up with a sign, I was like, who is that? I was like, where did he come from? Because I didn't even know we signed him.
2 days old. It's fresh. to me, obviously, and I hate to just beat the dead horse here, but it is the Hopkins.
Oh, absolutely.
Effect.
Yeah. I should have prefaced that by saying,
but minus Hopkins. Not Hopkins.
Right, right.
It's Kyler. I got to take the easy low hanging fruit, man. I mean,
okay. Well, let me change that then. Take away the superstars that you know are going to perform.
Okay, so the best underrated guy
that came in that you wouldn't.
Okay. Right, okay. Right. Okay. Let's see. I'm gonna go, and I got to remember his name too, though. Our backup center that just came in and held it down for Cole, because there was not. I mean, there's pressure everywhere, right? There's always pressure. And it looks worse because Kyler's always running.
Right.
So I don't know how much of the effect it was, but I just felt like usually when you lose your center, there's bad snaps, there's fumbles, things start to go wrong quick. That used to happen.
Right.
This didn't happen.
Right.
So the offense actually got into a rhythm still with a backup center.
Right.
That's huge.
I'm going to go with Deontay Campbell. That dude did what he just picked up where he left off with the Falcons. He just picked up where he left off. Tackle machine. Dude is in the right place all the time.
Ooh, I got one more.
Go ahead.
Man on fire, Dennis Gardak, baby. First special teams play, he's already starting to fight. First special teams play, he's already in there starting to push and shove and go crazy.
Gardak. Well, shout out to the special teams Ezekiel Turner did, because he was the point in that game where the game turned in our favor. To get us going,
because literally turned.
If easily we give them back that ball, we could be down 17. So good. I mean, shout out to the Dane special teams. Are we finally going to get some special team play this year? When was the last time we had good special team play from the kick and punt returns to blocks and those type of things?
It's been 5 years.
Oh man, it's been too damn long. I'm gonna go with another guy that I thought played very well. Now I ain't gonna say superstar well, but he did not look lost like he was before last year. My boy Hassan Reddick played a good game. Minus that losing his mind when Juszczyk get the big play, they come out the backfield. Minus that, yeah. Hassan played a ball. He balled out.
And you know where he was? He was rushing the quarterback.
Right.
That's when he did well.
And then he dropped into coverage and broke up a couple of crucial third down.
Still doesn't still makes me nervous.
Yeah, he does. He does. Because later, last year, our problem was when we scored, we relaxed.
Yeah.
And the other team would just go right down with a big play downfield. And that's exactly what happened after we scored the touchdown. When Kyler scored the touchdown, I'm like, okay, here we go. I said, now if the defense has been holding this whole time to 13, let's keep holding them and we should be fine. Bam. Hassan loses his guy on the outside and Juszczyk gets the big 40-something yard play. And that's usually what happens. He's used to doing that because he's, you know, he's still thinking when he's coveraging. But overall, he doesn't look as lost as he was last year. He looked like he's getting better.
Yeah.
And I like that. I like that a lot. We got to find a way. This dude balled out again. We got to find a way to get our dude, Chase Edmonds, some more touches. I know as hard as it will be with all these weapons, we got to find a way to get that guy some more touches. That dude's electric.
But I like that they're swapping him and Drake out almost every other play, it seems like.
Okay.
I like it. I mean, obviously, it just depends on the play call, too. But Chase is still getting a lot of action. If he's only getting six carries, he got 20 yards off of it. A 20-yard run, right? But 26.
We ran 78 plays. So that should be more than enough to get that kid on the field some more.
I'm with that.
78 plays, and throughout the day, we were in 22 personnel, 11 personnel, and 10 personnel all day.
Yeah.
So I mean, I don't know so much about the 22, because that's like leaving a lot of firepower on that bench if you've been 22 personnel for too long. But 11 and 10, oh, man, we was killing them. Killing them.
Oh,
and
yeah.
Going forward, we're going to kill a lot of defenses with that 10 personnel and 11, because – man, but yeah, I would love to see Chase get a few more touches, and you know, and to preserve Drake, because Drake runs hard. Both those guys run hard.
Yeah,
I get really concerned when he runs, because sometimes he's like he's gonna get hurt, because this dude just runs really hard. But props to the team for just standing up and not faltering like they would have last year. That would have been a loss last year for sure.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
That would have been a loss with no problem at all last year. So much to continue to talk about this game, man. Sean, I wish you could be here all week to talk about it, but
I know, man.
I got this promo I want to let you hear.
When you do the
closet thing, when you're in the closet, and we can only talk to you on sometimes in the closet. This is the promo for it.
All right, let me hear it.
Oh my goodness, I had to do it.
All right, you got too much time on your hands.
I got way too much time on my hands. McConnell in the closet.
Oh no.
That's the Kazual Sportz Show, y'all. I appreciate you, Bird Game, for sitting in and watching us again. And we got all week to go over this Cardinal game. And keep your eyes open for the neutral zone on Thursday night. We're going to have a special guest probably coming in on Thursday night.
Yeah, man.
Coming in for my man here. And we'll be looking for you in the closet, dude, somewhere down the line. Peace out, Bird Game.
Trapped in the closet.